Hey there, I'm Benjamin from Love's Data. Welcome to the fourth lesson in my Google Tag Manager training series. In this lesson, you'll learn about migrating and deploying Google Tag Manager on your website. We'll run through my checklist to ensure everything is ready before you publish your container. In previous lessons, we've covered the steps to get started, adding and testing tags. I've also included links to the other lessons in the description below this video. Okay, it's time to get started. The steps you'll need to take to migrate your implementation to Google Tag Manager will depend on the tags you currently have on your website. For example, if you're only using the Google Analytics tag and haven't made any customizations to the data it collects, then migration will be fairly straightforward. However, if you have added customizations to the Google Analytics tag and have other tags on your website, then you'll need to take time planning your migration. Let's walk through some of the different scenarios you might encounter. The simplest scenario is if you're just getting started. For example, if you're launching an entirely new website and you don't have an existing Google Analytics property. In this case, you can set everything up from scratch in Google Tag Manager. You'll create your property, get your measurement or tracking ID from Google Analytics, and configure your tags in Google Tag Manager. Then there is the scenario of just having the standard Google Analytics tag added to your website. You might be using a plugin, or maybe you've added the gtag.js tag to your website, but you're just using the standard tag and you haven't made any customizations to your tracking. In this case, you can add the Google Tag Manager code in parallel to the existing tag. Replicate the tag in Google Tag Manager, then publish your container and remove the existing tag. The next scenario is if you're using a modified Google Analytics tag or you've implemented customizations. For example, if you've added the gtag.js tag to your website and you've configured e-commerce tracking. In this case, you'll need to replicate the Google Analytics tag in Google Tag Manager, and you'll also need to ensure Google Tag Manager is configured to capture your e-commerce transaction details and pass them to Google Analytics. And continuing this scenario, you might have implemented additional customizations, like user properties for GA4 or cross-domain tracking for Universal Analytics. You'll need to take extra time to ensure these customizations are implemented using Google Tag Manager before you remove any existing tags from your website. And apart from Google Analytics, you'll also need to look at any other tags and any other third-party code you've added to your website. In most cases, these can also be migrated to Google Tag Manager. Okay, now let's run through my migration checklist. Depending on the current tags that have been added to your website, you can customize this checklist. And if you'd like to download a copy of my Google Tag Manager guide that includes this checklist, then you can find a link to get the guide in the description below this video. Step one is to create a list of your existing tags. This should include your Google Analytics tags and any other tags you've added to your website. It's also a good idea to make a note of how the tags are added to your website. For example, you might be using a plugin to add the Google Analytics tag to your website, or maybe you've added the Facebook pixel by pasting it into your website's template. Step two is to create a list of any tracking customizations you've made. For example, you might have implemented e-commerce tracking to record the items people purchase on your website. Or if you're using Universal Analytics, you might have added event tracking to report how many people are downloading a particular PDF on your website. Step three is to document your current implementation. It can be helpful to create a spreadsheet that contains all of the tags and customizations. This spreadsheet documents different tags currently used on a website, so you can then have a full view of all of the elements you'll need to implement in Google Tag Manager. Creating a spreadsheet like this is optional, but it's definitely useful if you have multiple tags and customizations you need to migrate to your container. Step four is to add the Google Tag Manager container code to all of the pages of your website. The way you add the container code will depend on the website platform you're using. For example, if you're using WordPress, then you might use a plugin to add the code to all of your pages. Or if you're using Squarespace, you'll use the code injection option to add the code. In the first lesson, we walked through adding the container code to our website. so feel free to rewatch the lesson if needed. I've included a link in the description below this video. Step 5 is optional, but if you are using a brand new Google Tag Manager container that has never been published, then you can publish the empty container before adding tags. We saw this in the previous lesson. Basically, if you've never published the container, the preview mode won't work. Step 6 is also optional. It's to work with your web developer to add a custom data layer to your website. A custom data layer makes information available to Google Tag Manager. For example, if you're using an e-commerce platform that doesn't provide a Google Tag Manager integration, then you'll want to implement a custom data layer that includes transaction details. This means that when a transaction occurs, you can pass all of the transaction details to Google Analytics, Google Ads, Facebook, and any other tags where you want to send e-commerce data. Step 7 is to check that variables have been enabled or created for any information you want to use in your tags and triggers. For example, if you want to track people clicking on a particular website promotion, you might need to enable the click class or click ID variables, so you can make use of the class or ID of the element someone clicks on your website. Step 8 is to create all of your tags in Google Tag Manager. This is where you take all of your notes from step 1, 2, and 3, and add all of the tags you're using to your container. Step 9 is to apply appropriate triggers to your tags. For example, when you add the default page view tags for Google Analytics, you can use the built-in All Pages trigger. This will mean the tag is added to every page of your website. Then for any tags that need to fire on individual pages or for specific actions, you'll need to create custom triggers in Google Tag Manager. Triggers can be created based on a whole range of actions, from the page someone is viewing, to the element they click, to watching an embedded YouTube video. There's a whole range of triggers. If you'd like to learn more about the different types of triggers you can create, check out the extra resources in the description below this video. I've included a link to my Google Tag Manager glossary. Step 10 is to test all of your tags using the preview mode. We covered Tag Assistant and the preview mode in the previous lesson. If you missed it, then I've included a link in the description below this video. Finally, step 11. Once you're happy with the tags, triggers, and variables you've added to Google Tag Manager, it's time to publish your container. The important thing to remember is that when you publish your container, you should remove any tags that are still hard-coded on your website. For example, if you've added the Google Tag Manager container code to your website, and you also have the Google Analytics tag on your website, then when you publish the container, you should remove the Google Analytics tag. This is because you'll now have the tag in Google Tag Manager, and you don't want it duplicated on your website. So they're the steps you need to follow to migrate to Google Tag Manager. Then whenever you need to add a new tag or modify an existing tag, you can make the changes in Google Tag Manager without having to change the code on your website. And when you do make changes, don't forget to preview and test your changes before they're published. If you'd like to continue learning about Google Tag Manager, then please subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. In the next lesson, we'll cover conversion tracking using Google Tag Manager. I'll see you in the next video.